It is my pleasure to introduce our guest, Professor Roman Boracki from the Faculty of Electronics and Information Technology of our university. And I need to say that from our philosophical perspective, it's really important to cooperate with Faculty of Electronics and Information Sciences, but also with people with some, let's say, strict background, because our philosophy at our university is strict philosophy with some scientific, let's say, background. And the topic of our lecture would be methodological and ethical contents in the curricula of PhD studies. And that would be the content in the context of quite new book published in De Bruyter by Professor Roman Boracki, Techno-Scientific Research, Methodological and Ethical Aspects. And I hope that we will be, after the seminar, we will be familiar a bit with the content of the book also. Yes. It's late now, because 50 minutes after 12 we start. That's why I stop here and
thank you very much for your introduction. My profession, I'm professor of meteorology. Not meteorology, but meteorology. So it's better to say measurement science and technology. It's an interdiscipline. That's why in 50 years of my academic career, because in fact I was involved in the first research project in 69, so exactly 50 years, after giving my first lecture in physics in 68. So it's even more than 50 years of experience of collaboration with people from various disciplines, because measurements apply to all empirical sciences, to medicine, to various areas of practical life. And this gave me a kind of pluralistic background, plus my interest in some non-technical issues like philosophy, psychology, ethics. This is what I'm going to say, the product of this personal background. I'm glad to have the opportunity to speak about issues which are of importance for the discussion about the research university, because a definitional feature of a research university is the quality of PhD studies. Extreme research universities like Stanford University in the United States practically have no undergraduate students, but they have a lot of PhD students, and the second feature is a high selectivity at the entrance. So in my domain, since I was, I think, 15 times at Stanford, in my domain it's 14 to 1, the selectivity ratio at the entrance. We had at the Faculty of Electronics 1 to 11 in the year 67 when I entered this university. Now it's difficult to calculate, according to the ministry we have 5, but it's not close to reality, because candidates may apply for various faculties, and the calculation of the real ratio is leading rather to 1.5 than to 5. So, the discussion about PhD studies is of importance, and in this context, my experience seems to be relevant. I'm going to follow the plan, which in fact I distributed in the abstract. So I'm going to present and justify 5 statements I believe are of importance for today's meeting. Namely, techno-science is the result of integration of technology with empirical sciences, including not only physical sciences, but also life sciences, social sciences, and cognitive sciences. The development of technoscience is today unthinkable without formation of new researchers being aware of this nature, mixed nature of techno science, of this close relationship between technical and non-technical aspects inside of techno science. The enhancement of non-technical contents of the curricula of PhD studies is therefore extremely important. It's a kind of challenge our university is facing, because the discussion about PhD studies in the context of new act on higher education, in the context of new solutions, doctoral schools, and in the context of the application of our university for the status of research university is extremely important. The priority, in my opinion, maybe very subjective, should be given to selected elements of philosophy of science and research ethics. The book already announced is a kind of my personal response to this challenge. The selection of the contents in this book is what I would like to recommend as a basis, a starting point for discussion about the solutions which may be worked out at our university. I will start with some boring, two boring slides, namely terminological remarks. Terminological comments seem to be appropriate because the words I'm going to use are not necessarily without ambiguity understood everywhere and by everybody. So, starting from science. In the Anglo-Saxon tradition, humanities are not sciences, are outside of sciences. Moreover, there is an expression, natural sciences, I do not use it, because according to some classification, mathematics is natural science, in particular according to the classification OECD, proposed as a basis for the classification of scientific disciplines in Poland. I'm not going to speak about what I call formal sciences like mathematics and logic. I do not contest the importance of mathematics for science. It's the heart of every empirical science, especially that within measurement science, my specialty is processing of measurement data. So, several years ago, I calculated the number of courses on mathematics I attended and compared with the number of courses on electronics. It turned out that it is 1 to 10 in favor of mathematics. So, importance of mathematics is absolutely indisputable for us, but at the same time, what I'm going to present applies to so-called empirical sciences in this sense. Technology. Technology is another word which now is tending to, in Polish language, is tending to converge with the English meaning. But traditionally, technologia is not technology. Technology is technika in Polish language. While technology, according to what as was taught 50 years ago and what is still in the dictionaries, is the way of production, way of manufacturing. That's why our faculty changed the name in 94 to Elektroniki i Technik Informacyjny, not to Technologii Informacyjnej. But it happened that just a year or two after, the Ministry of Education introduced the subject Technologie Informacyjne to the program. So, for some people today, the name Technik Informacyjne is confusing. Here I use technology in this Anglo-Saxon meaning, and technoscience is not a technical science or technical science, a group of technical sciences, as some authors seem to interpret this concept. No, it's the result of integration of science and technology, which were completely separate in the 19th century. This process started, in fact, in the last decade of the 19th century, continued very intensively during the first 50 years, and then Gaston Bachelard, the French philosopher, introduced this term. It remained that during 20 years, till the 70s, when Belgian philosopher Gilbert Ottois started to popularize this term. And today it's very extensively used in English, in French, in Italian, technoscienza. In Polish it appears rather exceptionally. But it sounds well, technonauka, it sounds well for me. What does it mean, integration? Integration, roughly speaking, means in this case that industry started to be a laboratory for science, science started to be research and development component of industry. And scientific method. Here, the comment required is the distinction between singular and plural form. When we speak about scientific method, that we mean the most general paradigm of empirical sciences. When we speak about scientific methods, we mean specific methods which are applied in a given science or in a group of sciences. Philosophy of science is what most frequently is named methodology of science in Polish language, also in Russian and German language. And this is justified by a very important distinction. In this respect, it's a kind of exception, Polish language is richer than English language. Namely, we have methodologia and methodica. While methodology means both in English, so to avoid this confusion, preferences for philosophy of science. Of course, there are numerous texts in Polish language where Philosophia Nauki is in the title, but the book, for example, Adam Grobler, Methodologia Nauki, is probably the most frequently used by the students now. Methodica in Russian language, methodik in German language, this is functioning, is it practically eliminating the possibility of confusion. There is a research methodology, and it is understood in English in two ways, at the general level and the specific level of a domain, but it's much closer to everyday practice of research than what is methodologia nauki in Polish language. And the last term, research ethics. We use rather ethics than moral philosophy of morality. In English, moral philosophy is more frequently used than ethics, again because of the double meaning of ethics. In singular form, when this is, means the philosophical discipline, and plural form, when it means specific ethical moral principles. But this second application does not appear in the philosophical books, it appears in everyday language. So, the end of the comments, and the kind of quotation I quote the sentence pronounced by Richard Feynman in 1953. It's a person close to us, because I had all the courses of physics based on his lecture notes translated into Polish at that time, and I had one semester with Professor Kocinski, who just returned from Caltech, California Institute of Technology, after listening to the courses of Feynman. And the characteristic feature of his lecture was that after introducing a new concept or term, he translated it into English and added the pronunciation. In this way, we learned language of physics not only in Polish but also in English. But this sentence, some historians question that it was pronounced by Feynman, it's another story, but the sentence is very good. Philosophy of science about as useful to scientists as ornithology is to birds. He was at that moment 35 years old. 20 years later, he changed mind and he wrote, first pronounced the opening speech, inaugural speech at Caltech, and this photo is from this moment. And next, the paper was published, it is circulating in the internet, it's easy to get it. If you write agrocultural science, you will find it very nice paper. Namely, he noticed that the majority of scientists, his contemporaries, are not understanding what they are doing. They are repeating research rituals with the hope that if those rituals were successful in other cases, probably it would be successful in their cases. Why carbocult? Because during the Second World War, they had military bases on the Pacific Ocean, and from time to time, the planes brought various attractive objects for survival to the soldiers, and soldiers share chocolates and so on with local tribes, and they associated this chocolate with planes coming. After the Second World War, there was no more military bases, but from time to time they could see a plane on the sky, and they started to pray to this to bring chocolate or something similar. Of importance is another quotation provided here by Albert Einstein in his letter to his friends in 1944, where he noticed that the lack of historical, sociological, philosophical background has negative impact on the independence of thinking of the researchers, and that this independence is the demarcation line between, as he put it, mere artisan or specialist on the one hand side, and real seekers after truth. And the next slide has in the subtitle this differentiation. I may say from the very beginning that for me it's not an alternative. We need both kinds of people. The only criterion is that both should be put in their category, not fake specialists and fake seekers of the truth. And this is the subtitle addressing the key issue in my presentation of today: what we expect of the young researchers, so of the holders of the PhD degree. We expect that they will realize the key aims, objectives of science, so generation of knowledge. Generation of knowledge, correction of knowledge, and synthesis of knowledge, these are three main goals of science. Why, when I asked during the first lecture my PhDs attending the course on methodological and ethical aspects, what you consider the most important achievement in science? First two immediate answers were receiving a scientific degree, publishing in a good, and after a moment of silence with uncertainties, a stranger, I think he's from Spain, said, maybe a discovery? So I commented that within 3 years, when I opened my new lecture, asking the same question, I will receive the answer: what is the main achievements of science? 200 ministerial points. This is the main scientific achievement. So we expect of the PhD holders that they will be able to generate knowledge of why type and how type. How type is particularly important for a technical university like ours. That they will be able to go beyond their graduation. If not, they will be not able to communicate between themselves, to collaborate fruitfully. We expect of them that they will be able to be creative, not only a year after graduation, but 25 and more years later. I recently listened to the German podcast on the Finnish system of education. It's considered to be the best in the world. And the distinctive feature of this system is the set of well-defined goals, 7 goals. And there is no names of physics, economy on this list. The first point is important here. Namely, the first objective of the school is to learn pupils to learn. And this applies to this issue, our issue. We expect of them, the educators, to work individually, to be productive individually and collectively. In this Finnish system, this collective work is also stressed very much. Namely, after 15 minutes of introduction to the lessons of mathematics, students are solving problems. And those who are quicker are obliged to help those who are slower within the classes. In various cultural, social, and economic environments, it's something that I didn't have to go into comment on. During the last 30 years, I worked with practically all the nations of the world, including Indians in the sense from American Indians, including various very exotic, let's say, representative of very exotic populations. Taking into account plurality of moral, pragmatic, and aesthetic values. In such multicultural, multinational teams, you must be prepared to exchange without emotions, confrontative attitude. Otherwise, the substance will suffer. There will be no productivity. My deputy in the Canadian company was my former PhD student, already with PhD degree. He was a Muslim praying 5 times a day. And we traveled across California together, having common room. He had always Quran. The Bible is always in the hotel, American hotels, and in the evening we had nice exchange of the differences between Islam. Never unhealthy emotions. So it's important. So as a consequence, I became the honorary member of the Cultural Society of Tunisian, because he was of Tunisian origin in Canada. The PhD holders are expected to face various challenges. Two first are obvious. Growing complexity and interdisciplinarity, we speak about it every day. Growing sophistication of hardware and software tools we use in research. If you compare the software libraries in the early 70s with what we have today, it's the problem in itself, how to use it with understanding. But the third, growing difficulty to find new ideas, may be surprising for some of you, because we live under the impression that the number of ideas is growing exponentially now, which is not true. The number of journals is growing exponentially. The finances are growing linearly, not exponentially, even in the richest countries of the world, but it has turned out that each new idea requires more money, more human resources, material resources in general, and this report quoted here, written by very good experts from both Eastern and Western coast, namely from MIT and from Stanford, is very significant in this respect. It's an extensive text showing how this difficulty to generate new ideas is growing. I would say, using Newton's words, that we are staying on the shoulders of the giants, and we are using now to the extreme the ideas generated during this fantastic period of science between the last decade of the 19th century and first 5-6 decades of the 20th century. We use them mainly transforming them into new technologies, transforming them into money, into business in general. But of course, there are limits. If we overlook some opportunities, we will suffer, and they are already signs of this suffering. PhD holders are expected to make decisions under pressure on uncertainty about aftermath of techno-scientific progress. I'm not opting for returning to axiological neutrality of science, not at all. The reflection is absolutely necessary, even more than in the past. But we should not cherish the illusion that we are able to control the result consequences of our research. I remember in 67, when I entered the faculty, my uncle, judge by profession, asked me what is my choice. I said medical electronics. He said why, and 17 years old, I answered, because it's most difficult to turn against humanity. And he said, you are very naive, there is no such a good thing which cannot be turned against humanity. And since then, of course, I have been confronted with many, many beautiful exemplifications of this truth. But it doesn't mean that we should abandon reflection on what we are doing, even if we are unable to fully control the aftermath. Conflicting values. Complexity means more values are involved in every decision-making process, in the dilemmas we have to resolve. And this requires understanding of the nature of the dilemma, understanding of the system of values, understanding of the methodologies, the best methodologies which people have developed during the history of civilization to resolve such dilemma. And of course, bureaucratic management of technoscience. I wrote 7 years ago, 2 years ago, a paper on the science in the times of bureaucracy. It is available in the internet on the website of our faculty, in particular. A year later, there's a chapter of a book. So I will not focus on it. The PhD formation is currently dominated by very specific substance-related topics, technical substance-related topics, and if non-technical issues are concerned, so pragmatic issues such as project management, transfer of technology, commercialization of research results, this is absolutely necessary but not sufficient. And it is dominated, if we speak about direct instruction of PhD advisors, with obsession of and paranoia of impact factor. These are the words of the inventor of the impact factor, Eugen Garfield. In 1955, he established the Philadelphia Institute of Scientific Information. And 2 or 3 years later, he invented impact factor as a tool for librarians to facilitate their work in selecting journals. The budget is always limited, so to select. In 1990, after 10 years of American use and abuse of impact factor in the systems of evaluation, he wrote a very nice paper, two-page paper, Slow Science is Good Science, and he explained that the impact factor has its place, but cannot replace what is science. Very elegant paper, very calm, very moderate in expression. But when in 2005, at the age of already 80-something, he was invited to Chicago for the conference on bibliometric measures and so on, he delivered the speech and wrote the title. Because it's another example that you never know what may happen in your good invention. The same was with napalm, which was developed by a PhD student for increasing productivity of crops. And 10 years, 15 years later, it was used in Vietnam. And this guy who invented napalm started to organize campaigns, and napalm is forbidden now in the United States. The same applies to impact factor, which started to destroy science all over the world. It's still far from being neutralized by reasonable analysis of the situation. And this picture on the right hand side, which is related to impact factor, is from the guidelines in Genossische Hochschule Zürich for students. What is written here is course publication, longer list of publications. One of the catches which is applied for increasing bibliometric indicators. The curricular study, in my opinion, should be significantly enhanced with conceptual basis of philosophy of science, general discipline-specific methodological issues, conceptual basis of general ethics, and some elements of research ethics. Maybe different for different disciplines, because bioethics is of importance for biomedical engineering, of less importance for some others. How it is at the research universities, two examples, Stanford and Berkeley, they have three centers for ethics with various orientation and a lot of material produced. And the second example is relatively new for me because I have not discovered starting the book that this concept of integration of methodology with ethics is already alive. Namely, Norwegian universities, after consolidation, all offer this kind of courses. Titles are different, proportions are different, but this concept of integrated ethics, research ethics and research methodology is the only present there. And about my personal experience, which led me to starting this work on the book. The research methodology, I proposed already being member of local committees at the faculty related to curriculum. In 1981, it was a special committee for non-technical courses, and we introduced electiveness of the courses. And the consequence of this move, there was a period of freedom, solidarity movement, and so on, was that students could choose, and the highest score received the course of philosophy of religion offered by Professor Svienko. You remember him or not? No? So it was at that time. He was an atheist, but it didn't matter for the philosophy of religion. And the second course was an external person, very well known now, Martin Krul, History of Poland, he offered. There was six groups for the history. And so it was one full semester, and the beginning of the next semester, martial law was introduced, and of course the culprits were punished, including my modest person, for this experiment. 89, in fact in 88, the dean of the faculty, Professor Ebert, appointed the gang of four assistant professors, 40 years old roughly at that moment, including me, Professor Woźnicki was in this group, and in January produce a vision of the future development of the faculty, neglecting all the constraints which exist around. That was the formulation of the task at the very beginning. And I presented the work of this group in January 89 in front of the faculty council. And when I said that the methodology of science sciences should be included in the curricula of graduate studies, master's and PhD. One of the members of the faculty council, you may remember, he heard a very relevant voice, he was in electroacoustics, he said, "Gentlemen, I have heard about Academy of Sciences, but not about methodology of sciences." So, from the East. When being in the office vice dean and dean, I could travel to the annual conference of American Society for Engineering Education. So we published there always 2-3 papers on the educational system with Andrzej Kraśniewski, Jerzy Woźnicki, with Toczyłowski, and so on. This is a huge conference. Dominated by Americans. Strangers are at the level of 5%, not more. 3,000, 4,000 participants, so 25 parallel tracks, and one of them, engineering ethics, or research at engineering ethics. I attended those courses and I was impressed by this omnipresence of such courses at American universities. And of course, I quickly learned that this is not a fantasy or a laugh for humanities. This is the need, the aftermath of what happened in the 70s and 80s when abuses of various kinds in research started to be quite common. The first paper I wrote in 2004, I will not add an anecdote how it happened, for the Conference on Meteorology, which was held in St. Petersburg. It's an interesting story. Ethical aspects of measurement related research and engineering practice. It was a keynote speech. The whole conference was devoted to measurements from technical and scientific point of view, but one of the keynotes was my speech. And what happened? There was a 2-year-long discussion over internet related to, it never happened in my life, with respect to another presentation, another paper. In particular, immediately after, the Russians came asking me for the rights to translate into Russian language. Within 2 weeks, I received, of course I agreed, because I felt it's my mission, not fighting for points at that time, still fight for points was relatively moderate in comparison to what we have today. And it was published in the journal Datchik, which is censors in English. Yeah. So the first course, Różne aspekty działalności badawczej w technice, during 3 years, starting in the academic year 2006-07, I delivered within the program of the Center of Advanced Studies. It was the Professor Janeczko invitation for this. It was 15 hours course for PhD students from maximum 12 faculties, if I remember. I learned a lot about how different practices at different faculties, how geodesy is different from electronics, for example, if the customs related to applications are concerned. The first book appeared at Warsaw University. The title is provided here. It was a similar story as here, but at that time I already lectured in English and I planned to publish it at our Warsaw University of Technology Press, but colleagues from the university obviously know in English there is several meters of shelves of such books. We need such a book in Polish, and we should not be involved in writing such books because we are inside of the society, so we must be specialized. And you are a dilettante, you are amateur, you may do, nobody will accuse you of lack of depth in the approach. And in this way, this book appeared there. So, it's the past, and the current experience is related to 2 courses, Ethical Aspects of Research and Engineering. I started in 2007. It was the invitation of the coordinator of the English Medium Studies at our faculty, Professor Kotaza. The structure is 24 hours of lectures, 6 hours of tutorials, discussions animated by the students according to some instruction provided to them. The same course, but differently structured, once a year for the program Athens. You know, the program Athens is an exchange of 20 universities. Students come for a single week for a single course. So I must complete everything from Monday to Friday. And our students, of course, well, it's well-balanced exchange European universities, but sometimes students from Paris are from South America or some other regions in the world. And in 2014, I started the course Methodological and Ethical Aspects of Research. It was the initiative of Professor Krasniewski, who at that time was the coordinator of PhD studies at our faculty. And after the introduction of new Senate statement on the necessity of ethical and methodological contents in the PhD curricula, he came to me to suggest the involvement, and I followed his advice, so I gave once a year several rounds, and the result is this book, which is and now a few words about the book. Moral deficiencies do not generate obstacles, while in case of a researcher, it at least one semester of instruction or more, or 7 years of instruction, in fact. That's why this methodological part must be embedded, even if the course is generally devoted to ethics. For me, this inclusion of methodology, extension, was very natural. Exposition of measurement as a principal tool of experimental science. Not because I'm a metrologist, not only, but I noticed that in the books, philosophy, on philosophy of science, written mainly by professional philosophers of science, the term measurement appears. Sometimes 300 times, I counted on the PDF, it's an easy task. But if the measurement error is concerned, it is absent or appears 3 or 4 times. If measurement uncertainty appears, it's in general absent. So, this is the main tool of experimental science. It's impossible to speak about uncertainty of scientific knowledge ignoring the uncertainty of measurement. This is the main motivation behind this part. Methodology of ethical decision making focused on moral dilemmas. So, as I said, this is the key issue, because if there is no conflict of values, a reasonable approach plus logical thinking is enough. In case of dilemmas, it's not like this. Mendeley table of ethical systems. I claim already in this published book, I put it, that any ethical system may be decomposed into 3 components, like any substance into elements from the Mendeleev table, namely virtue ethics, consequentialist ethics, and deontological ethics components, and the systems differ in proportions. And the most controversial are those systems which have 0 in 1 of 3 positions, so kind of extremists like deontological ethics or And this is illustrated with engineering approach, namely, I draw the analogy between optimization problem in engineering and decision making in ethics and moral decision making. Namely, consequences are criteria, deontological considerations are constraints, and virtue ethics related elements are correspond to the quality of the algorithm we use for performing optimization. So we optimize the consequences, but within constraints, for example, like don't kill or some other constraints. Holistic treatment uncertainty is something I will develop on the next slide. And more than 200 illustrative examples. In the Polish book 2011, it was marked with gray background. Here, but it was the decision of the editorial office. It's marked with different font, smaller and differently shaped, but it's easy. I remember that many readers of my previous books appreciated mainly the examples, omitting, skipping the general considerations. And this is the general structure of the book. There are three categories of contents, namely methodological, ethical, and auxiliary contents. Because I cannot assume certain knowledge from the secondary school concerning ethics, history of science, logic, language, and so on. So I introduced in a very brief way, and the three first chapters are mainly dominated by auxiliary contents. Next is domination of methodological contents. Here, chapter 11 dominated by ethical contents, and next we have a nice mixture of three with ethical domination. That's why the title, the adjective ethical, in the construction. And I will make general overview of the table of contents. So we have here selected concepts of philosophy and logic, next followed by science in historical perspective. I notice already within the courses of numerical methods and processing of measurement data that students are lost in time. They have no feeling what does it mean ancient Greece, Middle Ages, and the times of Newton. For example, when starting the chapter on the algorithm for solving nonlinear algebraic equations, I give two introductory examples. The Heron algorithm for drawing the square root, which was the main tool in my Lyceum for calculating square roots in the 60s and the 60s, and the Newton's algorithm for solving more general nonlinear equations. So, I ask without hope for the answer, please locate in time Heron and Isaac Newton. Normally there is no answer or absurd answers. When I say Heron is the beginning of our era, and geographically, no answer. Sometimes it happens with some more, let's say, sensitive to this, those issues students appear. I say in Alexandria. And what was the language of Heron? Of course, the choir is answering Arabic, because Alexandria is in Egypt today. Yeah, so this type of anecdotes have to support a lot. So it's necessary. I comment on the names which appear in numerical methods, Runge, Kutta methods for solving the differential equations. So I say when, why, who, and so on. That's why I included this chapter, Science in Historical Perspective. This is a kind of extended definition of science also. And I added an appendix where there is a chronological table of main achievements of science, which are not points, not publications, but certain ideas, new ideas. Next, we go to the philosophy of science in historical perspective. And then the regular methodology starts with mathematical modeling of mainly physical objects, which is necessary to properly present measurement as the principal tool of empirical sciences. Scientific explanations appears before starting the research process. Why? Because I use scientific methodology of scientific explanation in the context of justification. This is exactly what is the criterion for evaluation. The explanation power of the new theory also. I use two terms introduced by Hans Reichenbach, namely context of discovery, a bit of psychology of creative work there, not only formal approaches, and the context of justification. And the central chapter, I consider it very important, is uncertainty of scientific knowledge. I will make zoom on this chapter later. Next, basic concept of Western ethics starts, overview historical of Western ethic system of values. If I'm going to speak about conflicts of values, so I must not only introduce the concept of value, but also to classify the values confronted with in the research, and then the general overview of the research cycle, and zooms on most important aspects. Maybe the only comment needed is ethical issues related to usage of information technology. It's not because my faculty is the faculty of electronics and information technology, but because information technology is as important today as measurement in every empirical science. And some concluding remarks. And this zoom on uncertainty of scientific knowledge. This is not only uncertainty of observation and measurement. This is also the uncertainty related to naive understanding of scientific method, which is propagated by the schools, in fact. We, at schools, repeat what was roughly established in the mid-19th century, how science works. The notation problem, of course, so differentiation between what we call science and non-science. By non-science I mean pseudoscience and junk science, and they are various categories of non-science. More uncertainty of scientific reasoning, so of induction and abduction, but also deduction due to what Kurt Gödel discovered. Uncertainty of observation, of course, this is the quantitative uncertainty to be evaluated, and some remarks on integration of uncertainty of scientific knowledge. In a certain sense, James Clerk Maxwell is the godfather of our faculty, field theory, and he used to say, again, the historians are not in agreement about whether this sentence was pronounced by him or he repeated, it's not important, that the ability to deal with uncertainty is the sign of maturity. And I agree with this wisdom, this location. And to conclude, rather instead of conclusion, I'm going to answer a question which is frequently asked: why I'm involved in this kind of activity? I already was asked in 2007, and my answer is provided here. I simply noticed that at a certain moment of my career, it's more important to activate, to make sensitive my students to this kind of issue, rather than to develop 256 algorithms for processing measurement data. Thank you very much for your kind attention.